Sperm whales. Once feared as deep-sea monsters, hunted to the ends of the earth and turned into targets. But here's the plot twist. In trying to destroy them, we actually got to know them. And what we found are not monsters, but gentle giants. Intelligent, emotional, and deeply social. These ocean titans talk to each other. They cuddle, play, and raise their young in tight-knit family pods. Their bonds, unbreakably strong. Maybe even stronger than human families? Sperm whales are animals of the extremes. They are deep-sea giants. Female sperm whales get up to 12 meters long and can weigh 17 tons. Bulls grow even larger, reaching up to 20 meters in length and weighing 50 tons. That makes them the largest toothed whale. The only two animals that are bigger are fin whales and the largest animal to have ever lived on our planet. The blue whale. But sperm whales triumph over them in other aspects. For example, with their giant brains. Sperm whales have the largest brain of any animal. They use it to navigate the deep ocean in search of food, and to manage the complex social structures within their pods. And their big brains would probably also tell them to hit that subscribe button, if they had fingers. Their social life is likely a significant reason for why they have such large brains. Sperm whales even have special neurons that help with the formation of relationships. They are biologically wired to discern emotions. They even have favorite individuals, or as we might say, friends, which they tend to stay closer to and talk to more often. Sperm whale society is structured into clans. The clans are huge. One clan can contain thousands of whales and span over thousands of kilometers of ocean. The main distinguishing point? Vocal dialects. But more on sperm whale communications a bit later. The foundational building blocks of the massive clans are much smaller. Sperm whales tend to live in tight-knit, matrilineally based groups called social units. The size of these families can vary, ranging from 4 to 20 individuals. They often consist of related females and their offspring. The calves act as a sort of a social hub, with mothers, aunts, and grandmas sharing caring duties. These adult females all travel together, suckle each other's infants, and even babysit them while the mothers make long, deep dives to feed. Babysitting is a vital part of sperm whale society. Calves are not yet able to dive to the same depths as the adults, leaving them vulnerable at the surface. So, for their mothers to be able to grab a bite, another whale helps them look after the little one, protecting them from threats. And calves that were helped as an infant are more likely to help out their family once they are grown up. Also, sperm whales are one of the few mammalian species, alongside killer whales and us humans, where older females still play an important role in their family, even after they have stopped having offspring. The grandmas tend to take on more babysitting duties. These whales are clearly very social animals. Sperm whales are almost always seen close to one another, touching and rolling around each other for minutes to hours at the water's surface. The sperm whales do this on purpose. This is how they form important lifelong bonds. They also seem to defecate in unison when socializing. Just as a side note, the female-led social units prefer to stay in tropical waters, such as around the island of Dominica and the Caribbean, or the Azores in the North Atlantic. This is where they play, cuddle, and talk with each other. Males leave these social units as they grow older and often congregate in loose bachelor groups. As they grow in size and age, males migrate towards the poles to feed. Once old and big enough, typically in their late 20s, they return to the tropics to socialize and mate. And once finished, they return to their northern feeding grounds. This awards the sperm whale with another extreme: the greatest sexual segregation of any species. But let's return to clans and social units. Scientists have analyzed vocal samples recorded in the Pacific Ocean and identified around 7 different clans there. Each clan is made up of numerous social units, which are essentially families of closer related individuals. These family units frequent certain areas together. Although social units from different clans can be found in the same regions, interactions among these units are typically limited to members of their own clan. Within their clans, these family units form social groups, communicating and playing together. But how do we know that? Sperm whales use an identifier called codas, and different clans have different codas. A coda is a series of short click sounds that sperm whales make when they interact with each other. Codas are like dialects. Some codas are very distinct to a specific clan, thus called an identity coda. Different clans have varying numbers of identity codas, and scientists are trying right now to decode this unique language. Interestingly, clans not only have separate codas, but seem also to have distinctive non-vocal behaviors. Scientists observed 2 clans around the Galapagos Islands. Each clan had distinct large and small-scale movement patterns that matched with their identity coda. Also, their babysitting strategies seemed to be distinct for each clan. All these behaviors, as well as the codas themselves, must be learned through social learning within the family. Sharing information or behavior within a group or community and acquiring it through social learning is the definition of culture. So, sperm whales clearly have some kind of culture going on. Another hint lies in the vocalizations of sperm whales. Baby sperm whales can't use codas immediately after birth. They need about 2 years to learn it. The calves are only babbling at the start, and adult whales use some kind of baby speech to talk to them. But how do sperm whales produce their sound in the first place? Well, it has to do with another extreme of this species, their giant nose. It is the biggest nose in the animal kingdom, helping the whales to hunt in the darkness of the deep ocean, communicate, and it is also the unfortunate reason for their name. In there is an oily substance called spermaceti. The whalers gave it that name because they thought it was semen, which of course it isn't. And so, the species was named after that. Spermaceti was also the main reason the sperm whale was hunted to almost extinction. Humans used it in cosmetics, industry, and most importantly, for the brightest candles. From 1800 until the 1980s, commercial whaling reduced the global sperm whale population to less than half of its original size, from around 2 million individuals to now around 840,000. Spermaceti is also crucial for communication. When a whale produces a click, the vibrations are generated at the front of the head and travel through the spermaceti organ to the back of it. There, they are reflected again to the front and are modified as they pass through another organ, the melon. These sounds can be extremely loud. A single click can reach about 236 decibels in volume. For reference, a normal conversation is around 60 decibels. A jet engine is about 110 decibels. And the human eardrum bursts at approximately 150 decibels. That makes sperm whales the loudest animals on Earth. Using these organs, sperm whales can produce a range of different sounds. Solitary males produce very loud noises that can be heard over long distances, likely to advertise their presence to females in the vicinity. The most common clicks are used for long-range echolocation, like a sonar for finding prey, and shorter clicks when they are about to catch prey. And then finally, the clicks referred to as codas, used for identifying one another. And these codas are the focus of scientists right now. We know that sperm whales live in a complex social world, especially within female social units. They chat while floating at the water's surface, playing and cuddling with each other. But for such complex lives, they don't seem to talk that much. Or do they? Sperm whale codas are arranged in at least 150 known repeatable patterns. Scientists have been working to examine them in isolation and analyze them with the help of AI. By plotting the codas in relation to each other and focusing on new variables like rhythm, tempo, or the length of sounds, this new research has revealed what the scientists call a sperm whale phonetic alphabet. The study has shown sperm whales frequently change the speed of their codas, and other whales producing the same coda mimic the change immediately. Scientists also believe there is evidence that sperm whales can spontaneously add new information to a coda. To get a sense of this complexity, think about how particular phrases can have slightly different meanings depending on how they are said or their context. Like, "Oh my God," has a very different meaning from, "Oh my God." Still, it is too early to say if these coda variations are even sentences in the way we as humans understand them. More research is necessary to make that clear. But still, this is a big step forward in decoding sperm whale communication. And whether these codas constitute a real language or not, one thing is clear. We are witnessing whale families engage in complex social interactions, maybe exchanging the newest deep-sea gossip. And isn't that, in itself, very exciting? These interactions are the basis of their tight-knit social units, where strong bonds are formed and kept through shared responsibilities and care. From mothers, aunts, and grandmas caring for calves, to the special babysitting practices, every aspect of their social behavior reinforces the strength of their family bonds. Sperm whale families are a proof to the importance of social bonds when living in a community. Their ability to communicate, care for each other, and maintain lifelong relationships highlights the extraordinary nature of these gentle giants of the deep ocean. Thank you for watching. Did you like this documentary? Tell us in the comments, and please like, share, and subscribe to the Terra Matta channel. Until next time.